Please call the roll.
Chairman Groff.
Here.
Counsel Barry.
Here.
Counsel Byer.
Present.
Counsel Fritz.
Here.
Counsel Jordan.
Yeah.
Counsel McGinty.
Here.
And Counsel Reed.
Present.
The Pledge of Allegiance to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic over which stands one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Is there a motion to move into executive session?
Mr. Chairman, I move that we enter executive session to discuss a legal matter with the town attorney and to receive information on the status of collective bargaining with the Cape Elizabeth Police Benevolent Association. There will be no votes taken or actions made outside of the public meeting, which will resume at 7:30.
I'll second it.
Okay. And could that, that motion, it says legal matter, could that be plural matters?
Excuse me, matters.
And the second accepts that?
Indeed.
All in favor? Opposed? 7-0 in favor. Of course, there for the public, there will be no votes taken in executive session. It is anticipated that we will reconvene in public session promptly at 7:30. We look forward to seeing you then. Thank you very much. Agents and then went into executive session and has now returned from executive session and will continue the meeting, which today's meeting date is March 11th, and this is meeting number 14 in the 97-98 year. The first item is citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Is there any such discussion that any citizen would like to have tonight? Hearing none. Reports and correspondence. Are there any councilors who would wish to report, give a report, or talk about any correspondence? Councilor
Mr.
Barry.
Chairman, four of the councilors, including myself, have just returned from the National League of Cities conference in Washington, D.C., but because of the length of the agenda tonight, we felt it would be more appropriate for us to perhaps submit a written report on what we have done down there and then bring that back to the council, because I know the folks want to get on here. So we appreciate the opportunity to go, and we think it was a good experience.
Great. Is there any other councilor reports or correspondence? I would like to take one moment and congratulate students in the Cape Middle School. They had a talent show this afternoon, which was just wonderful. And the fact, as we're meeting tonight, is the second part of the talent show. I think, in keeping with our one town concept, that it's important for the council to recognize outstanding achievements by our students as they happen. And I hope all of you are keeping abreast of the wonderful things that are happening in our schools here with our young people in Cape Elizabeth.
Two quick items.
And the town manager has two, what he promised to be, quick items.
First, I wanted to introduce Michael Feeney, who is an intern going to be working with us for the next few months. He's a recent graduate of a Master's of Public Administration program at Western Kentucky University. And he's going to be helping the town on some of our issues involving negotiations on pay classification plan, on athletic fields, and a few other issues. And I'd like to welcome Michael and appreciate the fact he'll be working with us.
Stand up, Mike, so everyone can see you.
Thank you. Secondly, I do want to make mention of some excellent work done by the police department over the last weekend. We had a burglary, I don't know if you're aware, at the Cape Elizabeth Middle School, also in the high school, in the Thomas Morrow Library, and I was very pleased that the police department was able to work on that particular issue and clear those burglaries, as well as a previous break-in at both the middle school and at the Methodist Church. There was a real potential for significant cost for the town as a result of some master keys having disappeared during the break-in. And Sergeant Sinclair, Officers Gaspar, Carson, and Sawyer were really instrumental in resolving this issue, and I'd like to congratulate and thank them for their work on behalf of the community.
Thank you. Any other councilors that have anything? Then I believe we could move forward to probably the most fun of the entire evening, and that is the presentation to the girls' swimming state champions. You coming to?
Not usually.
Girls, if you'd come up, and I always like it when the coach comes too. Come around this way too. Everybody likes to see you on TV. It's on about 10 times during the month, so they catch you once. Town of Cape Elizabeth, Cape Elizabeth Town Council Proclamation. Whereas the Cape Elizabeth Girls Swim Team earned the 1998 Maine Class A State Championship, and whereas this victory was the result of extraordinary effort in the final meet, with divers and swimmers striving for the best individual and team results of their competitive careers, and whereas, although Cape Elizabeth entered the meet as the underdog, they persevered and triumphed by piling up points in a multitude of events to claim victory at the finish. And whereas this first state championship in 4 years is the culmination of thousands of practices over many years with devoted attention to swimming and diving by the girls themselves, as well as by coaches, parents, and other volunteers now, therefore be it resolved by the Cape Elizabeth Town Council that we hereby congratulate the Cape Elizabeth High School girls swimmers and divers on the state championship, and we salute them, their coaches, their parents, and all others whose efforts helped lead to this victory, dated the 11th day of March, 1998, and signed by every member of the town council. Congratulations, girls. I thought maybe you'd like to say a few words.
Yes, I will. Thanks. There you go. Usually, when I receive this plaque for the achievement that the girls have achieved throughout the year, and last year when the boys won, I really haven't taken time to highlight some of the awards that our team have won this year, and I like just to do this. So I gave a copy to each town council member, and I just like to take the time. One thing that's really dear to my heart is the Maine Academic All-State team that four of our girls have achieved this year. To be on that team, you need to be a senior, a state qualifier, a varsity letter, award winner, and a GPA over 3.0. And this year we have Julie Ferris, Nina Hendrickson, Morgan McVain, and Rachel White, our academic all-state team. Quick clap. We also have All-State Top 16 awards, and that is from both Class A and Class B swimming and diving, and this is for over 850 girls in the state of Maine, approximately 42 teams. And this year we have Kirsten Alberry, Julie Ferris, Audrey Flynn, Nina Hendrickson, Morgan McVain, Laura Orcott, and Shauna Phillips all contributed, and they're the top 16 swimmers in the state of Maine. And also we compete in the Southwestern Maine All-Stars, and we have three swimmers, Kirsten Alberry, Julie Ferris, and Shauna Phillips, as Southwestern Maine All-Stars this year as well. And we do have two state champion relay teams, and these relay teams, if you've read the paper over the last couple of weeks, played an integral part of winning the state championship for us. We were state champions in the 200-yard medley relay and the 200-yard freestyle relay. And also, we had a school record broken this year by Kirsten Alberry. This school record was held since 1984, and she set the school record in the 500-yard freestyle at the state championships. And I'd just like to mention that we had approximately 26 girls on our swimming team this year, and 18 girls qualified for the state championship. It was about 70% of the kids who swim qualified. And those girls are Kim Collins, Nina Hendrickson, Julie Ferris, Morgan McVane, Rachel White as our seniors, and we're going to miss them next year. Our juniors, Kirsten, Mindy Christensen, Sarah Fisher, Aaron Gabrielson, Laura Orcott, Katie Shaley, and Katie Swope. Our sophomores, Julie Fisher, Audrey Flynn, Sarah Orcott, Shauna Phillips, and Wendy Weber, and our freshman, Jesse Mitchell. So congratulations to those girls. And I just like to say that I think this year's girls team epitomizes what high school athletics should be about. It's having fun, working hard, trying to do your best, and never giving up. So I would like to thank the parents, the coaches that have worked with me, and especially the girls this year, because it was a great time to win when the papers didn't count us even being in the top three, that when we walked away, we were the fastest swimmers and the fastest meet in the last two decades. So again, thank you, and great season.
We have the minutes of the previous meeting. Is there a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I would move that we approve the minutes of the February 9th meeting and the February 23rd meeting.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor? Opposed? 7-0. We have item number 105. This item was tabled on 2998. What was tabled was the action to establish Cape Elizabeth Public Safety Dispatch Center as a public safety answering point. Is there a motion to bring this item back before the council?
So moved.
Second? Councilor Reed, second. All in favor? This item is now back before the council. Is there a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I will move to approve the designation and to authorize the town council chair to sign all required documents.
Second.
Of the Cape Elizabeth Public Safety Dispatch Center as the public safety answering point.
Second. Second by Councilor Jordan. Discussion. For the public, there was an open workshop on this, and if you don't see discussion tonight, it's because it was a very productive workshop. Our chief did an excellent job explaining this whole issue to the council. Is there any councilor that wishes to make a statement of any kind? Hearing none, we should vote. All in favor? Opposed? Passes 7-0. Item 113, it's action to authorize the town manager to sign a supplemental engineering services agreement with Ost Associates for the town center sidewalk, traffic signal, and drainage improvements project. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, the town council looked at this project last month, and there was at least one councilor who was surprised that the proposal only went from Farm Hill Road up Scott Dyer along Route 77 only as far as Jordan Way. At one point, the town council had actually voted that they wanted the project to extend further all the way down to Fowler Road in phases. We had applied for a grant at one point that would have accomplished that. Unfortunately, the PACS, which is the Regional Transportation Funding Agency, and the Maine Department of Transportation declined to fund that grant. The engineers, since your last meeting, have gone forward and have done a preliminary cost estimate, both for the design work as well as for the actual construction, what it might cost to extend the sidewalks and the other improvements further down Route 77. The next phase, which would take it down to as far as the high school, was estimated at $482,000 as a pre-design estimate. And for the phase between the high school and Fowler Road, $168,935. As there are no local funds currently available for that, it would be, you know, unless the town council knows of another source that I'm not aware of, it would be my recommendation that you table this item and not provide the authorization. The additional design would cost The additional design, Steve? This is Steve Harding, the town engineer. We've got a lot of paperwork tonight.
The additional design for Phase 2 would be $45,660. For Phase 3, it'd be $15,700. If those two phases were lumped together, there'd be a savings, and it'd be a total of $54,815.
Yeah, so it would, you know, it would be the intent at some point to return to the town council, if you didn't agree to fund this this evening, to see if you're interested in having us apply for a grant, two packs during the next biennial round. We wouldn't automatically do that. We would come back to the town to do that. So it's the recommendation that that you not authorize the town manager to sign this agreement, because it's the sense of staff that we just don't have the funds available. I would also like to mention that we are going to be looking for a workshop date with the town council, scheduled later this month, trying to work around some finance committee meetings and other issues, or in early April, to have you review some of the preliminary concepts for the first phase of the project from Farm Hill Road to Jordan Way.
I will move that the town set the phase 2 and 3 of the town center sidewalk and drainage improvement project be tabled.
Second.
Tabled indefinitely at this point, not tabled to a...
I would say tabled indefinitely.
So that would be the motion, tabled indefinitely. Yeah. And there was a second by Councilor Barry.
Yeah.
Discussion. Councilor McGinty.
I just a question about phase 1. That's fully funded, right, Mike?
Yes,
we're
it
all
is.
Set to do it then.
Since it's a motion to table, there is no discussion. All in favor? Opposed? 6-1, the motion's tabled. The next item is a public hearing on the proposal to amend the zoning ordinance as contained in a citizen-initiated petition received from Phyllis Cogishel under Article 8, Section 2 of the Council Manager Charter of the Town of Cape Elizabeth. At this public hearing tonight, anyone is welcome to speak. We are hoping, and I would ask, that everyone's comments be limited to 3 minutes. The clerk has been requested to keep track of the time and advise a speaker when there is 1 minute left, and then also advise a speaker when the 3 minutes is complete. Are there any citizens that wish to speak?
Mr. Chairman, before we start, could either you or perhaps a town attorney, explain exactly what we're doing and what our responsibilities and our options are? I've had some discussions with some people in the last 24 hours or so, and I'm not sure that everybody knows exactly what we can and can't do with this citizen's petition, and it might be helpful to everybody if they knew exactly what our options are.
Thank you very much. With the consent of the council, then, I would ask our town attorney, Mr. Leahy, to come to the podium, and I think it would probably be helpful, Tom, if you gave the citizens a little bit better understanding of the petition process in a nutshell, and then what this is about tonight, and then under the statute, what can happen in the future, what has to happen in accord with the statute, and that might be a good introduction, so I appreciate it.
Thank you, Mr. Groff. I can do that as long as I'm not limited to 3 minutes.
Special exemption.
The town charter is your constitution, and it governs this procedure. Basically, you can adopt ordinances, and the citizens have the right to submit a petition signed by the requisite number of registered voters to adopt an ordinance. In this case, there's been a petition filed, it's been certified by the town clerk, it has the requisite number of signatures, and it is now ripe for your action either to schedule a referendum or at some point prior to that referendum, which is the vote, you can adopt the ordinance, but only the ordinance as presented in the petition. We as the, my office or myself as a town attorney has a role here and by the charter to review the petition to make sure it is correct grammatically and make certain changes, but none that could change the meaning or effect of the ordinance. To that end, I have given the council a letter and reviewed with the town clerk a proposed warrant and ballot. The process at this point, as mandated by the charter, is for the council to have a public hearing, and that's tonight, and both sides can address the issue. At some point, either tonight or within 30 days of tonight, this council has to schedule a vote by referendum on the petition, and as I said, any time prior to the vote, there is an option for the council to adopt the ordinance as presented. The vote could be at either a special election, and you also have a municipal election, a primary election, and a general election. The last three would be in May, June, and November, respectively. And between now and then, you could engage in whatever information gathering and debate on the issue that you may wish to obtain for the benefit of the citizenry, which will be voting on this amendment. What the amendment is to the zoning ordinance. It's specifically limited to the town center district. The proposed amendments are to add a paragraph to the purpose, to expand the purpose of the town center district. It is to adjust one of the criteria of the standards that would be applied by expanding the universe, if you will, of the properties that may be adversely affected, granting people beyond the abutters who presently have standing to come before the planning board, add a site plan approval before the planning board, and address whether they feel the project that might be proposed would negatively impact their values. And then the proposed ordinance under the petition would tighten up, and I believe it's four ways, the space and bulk provisions of the present ordinance. The maximum building height is currently 35 feet for all uses. There's nearly a 30% reduction by the proposed ordinance. There's a decrease in the size of a building footprint from 5,000 square feet to 3,500 square feet, which is about a 30% reduction. There's a proposed decrease in the maximum building dimensions from 100 feet to 75 feet, being approximately a 25% reduction. And there's a decrease in the maximum lot coverage, excluding in these space and bulk requirements, schools and municipal uses, from 70% to 50%. So the maximum lot coverage could be 50% if this were adopted, as opposed to 70%. Again, roughly a 30% reduction of that space and bulk requirement. So there are four space and bulk requirements that would be more restrictive, approximately 25 to 30% under this. It expands the area of standing of neighbors to from abutting to the neighborhood that may be impacted by a project, and it expands the purpose of uses, commercial uses, particularly in the town center zone. I think I've covered it.
Thank you. Now, this would be an amendment to the ordinance that most people in town have nicknamed Zork that was passed very recently by the town council. Is that correct?
That's correct. My understanding is that from about 90, I think it was 93 to 95, there was a town center planning committee. They made recommendations. Those recommendations were found their way into the ordinance, and then there was recently a fully revised zoning ordinance reflecting these provisions that are sought to be changed.
And also, behind you, the color photograph, just so we're all clear when individuals talk or at home, I don't know if it's visible, would that in large part be a photographic exhibit that would show the town center zone that we're talking about?
Not totally. I don't want to venture there. I think it does that and more. I mean, it includes some of the Atlantic Ocean, and I don't think that. So it's that plus more.
All right. So if people, but if that would be, that just so the public understands, that picture hangs in Town Hall. And so if you wanted an overview, if any member of the public wanted an overview of part of the town center zone, and not, I'm not representing it's complete, but a bird's eye view, that's always available. It's here. You can come look at it. And it's a little bit different view when you look down on the top and see the property and this town center. So I want to make sure everybody understands that that's here, hanging on the wall, available for people to look at.
We also have the aerial next to it, which is aerial photography that's available in the planning office if anyone wants to look at that at any point. And it, the lot lines are also shown on there.
May I address one other point? I neglected to state this, and I mentioned there are four space and bulk requirements. There was also a change in the building height definition, which is kind of a definition that's proposed. We have just clarified that it would apply only to this. Basically, the existing definition of building height, which the maximum would be 35 feet, would be changed to 25 feet, but it also presently is, it would be the average grade before construction today, and under the proposal, it would be the lowest grade, at the lowest point of the building, it would be the lowest grade that you would measure from, and then vertically, it would be the maximum building height, whereas under the existing ordinance, we would exclude certain architectural things such as clock towers and spires and cupolas or non-living areas. So I just want to be clear that there is a change by redefining building height for the zone that is also a restrictive change beyond the 35 to 25 foot.
Before you leave the podium, I want to make sure that if any councilors, before we start the public hearing, have any questions they wish to ask of you that they believe would help better define the public hearing, I want to give everyone an opportunity to do that. Councilor Reed?
This may be for the town engineer instead of the town attorney, but is 25 feet what an average Cape Cod residential home height would be?
Was she right? It's better for the engineer?
Yes, please.
With a roof that isn't flat, I mean.
I'm not really sure if she's right or not, but I would assume so. I don't really have that data readily available, but it seems to be something.
I'm just trying to get my visual to plank in that aerial view.
Yeah, I just a Cape Cod house. It's that would seem to be something that would be consistent with Cape Cod, but like I said, I'm not totally certain.
Thank you, Steve. Sorry to put you on the spot.
Are there any other questions by any counselor of the town attorney before we start the public hearing that would assist this public hearing? Councilor McGinty.
Again, I just want to make it clear that two things the council cannot do. We cannot change the language of this referendum petition. And number two, we cannot simply reject it. We either have to put it on the ballot or adopt it.
That's correct.
Okay. Just want to make that clear.
Thank you, Councilor. At this time, we will open the public hearing. Again, I would ask that your comments be limited in accord with my prior request. Anybody who wants to speak can line up, and please, when you come to the podium, identify yourself, and please give your address.
Ready, go.
I'm sorry.
Evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Richard Haupt. I live in Hopstone Condominiums. My wife and I have owned property in Cape Elizabeth since 1980. I've been following this at some length, and I certainly am in favor of the proposed restriction, changing the specifications for the town center plan to be more restrictive. I do have one question that, if I might present it to the town's attorney, because not having the town center plan handy, I'm not sure exactly what is meant by this, which was passed out tonight, and we haven't had a chance to study it.
You're talking about the attorney's opinion required by the town charter?
Well, that the part that refers to the accuracy of the text and referring to the how to determine the height of a building.
How do you determine height of the building?
Right. Right. My point is, it says in here, that term is already a defined term in the ordinance in section 19-1-3. My point is, how is that determined in that point? And the main, as I understand it, the main reason for requesting a more restrictive version is to change the point from whatever ground level point you start from. Instead of going halfway up the pitch of the roof, you go all the way to the ridge. And that was the reason for putting that particular wording in there. My point being, if you look at a house, you don't see just halfway up the roof, you see the whole house. And that's why I think it needs to be restrictive. If this does not, if the existing definition is still halfway up the roof, then I would still go along with reducing it to 25 feet, but I think it changes the basic purpose of the petition.
Well, I don't know if we're in a position to answer questions tonight. Obviously, you've given your interpretation of what the petitioner's intent was.
No, I'm reading from the petition.
Have any idea?
No, the petition says, the maximum building height should be 35 feet for school in this building, 25 feet for all the uses, and that building height should be measured from the lowest building elevation to the highest point on the roof. That's pretty explicit. It's my understanding that the town center plan says halfway up the roof. So that, is that correct?
Councilor, can you address this? I mean, I quite candidly, I'm not sure anybody in the council can address that definitively.
Once again, starting from the bottom, where you begin the measurement, under the existing ordinance, it is the average original grade. Okay, so you take the average, and under the proposal, it is the lowest point. Now going up the building, under the existing ordinance, it is the highest roof beams of a flat roof, or to the mean level of the highest gable or slope of a hip roof. Your building inspector is going to interpret that. I don't know what, you got to look at the building and see where the gables are, I guess, and if it's a hip roof or has a gable. But it says either the highest roof beams of a flat roof or the mean level of the highest gable or slope. Under the requested changes in the petition is simply the highest level. And you would not reduce it by any architectural renderings such as cupolas, clock towers, whatever, widow's walks, whatever is above, you know, you would go to the as high as you can go under the petition.
Thank you. Thank you. Are you
This was my understanding of it, and my point being the, is I think when you look at a house, you see the whole house. You don't see halfway up the gable roof. And I think that this, the wording in there was put in specifically. Now, obviously, the attorney has studied this and said that that definition, you didn't want to change the definition, is my understanding, because it's already defined. And is that, did I misread what you said?
I'd like to just add one point.
Go ahead, sir.
It's not what I want to change the definition. I cannot change the meaning or effect of the petition. So whenever we look at something like that and see that height is defined differently under the proposed ordinance, under the petition, and the existing ordinance, I am not at liberty to change it. All I can do is articulate tonight what I think the differences are and show and state. What I have stated is that the definition proposed under the petition is only for building height in the town center district, so that the remaining definition, because it's a defined term for the ordinance, still applies. We're only going to change it if this is adopted for the town center district.
Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Tom Tinsman. I live at 24 Ocean Avenue. I'm also an owner of a business property in the center of town. 349 Ocean House Road. I served on the Town Center Planning Committee that first met in 1991 and was fortunate to sit in on that meeting. I learned quite a bit while meeting with other people at Newton about zoning than I did, but we discussed a lot of issues that are currently in force in the town and discussed at great length what these proposals that we made to the town council would have on the town center. I'd like to say that I'm opposed to this amending ordinance for a number of reasons. Number one, the height limitation right now for 35 feet seems to me to be a very adequate height restriction. You can build a home just about anywhere in Cape Elizabeth with a height restriction of 35 feet. I don't understand why a business zone where you're trying to encourage business growth instead of spread out all over the town would be less than what you could build a house for in the town. But a greater issue than that is the fact that about 25% of the properties that are currently in the town center zone would become non-conforming buildings if this is amended. And I would like to know what that means when a property becomes a non-conforming use and what ramifications that's going to have for anyone coming before the planning board for proposals. My building specifically would be in that classification. My building would become non-conforming and would have adverse impact on my property value. The wording that's currently in the town center zone, I'm not sure why we would want to change that to read something that says predominantly smaller commercial and professional buildings than found in neighboring towns and cities. We're not really comparing ourselves with other towns. We specifically made a proposal that we felt was best for the town of Cape Elizabeth. And I don't think we need to compare ourselves with other towns or to say that we're going to be smaller than other towns. I think we considered those things. And one other point, Section B of this amendment, I've heard different arguments on this item, but where it says no project shall create an adverse impact on the value of neighboring properties. We currently have it, I guess, on abutters to the town center zone, but I'm not sure, and even being in real estate, I don't know who could define what an adverse impact is or who can prove that. And I don't think we have standards currently that really address that. I mean, I've asked the question of many different people, haven't really gotten any good answers as to what does create an adverse impact and who is the final say on that. And if we're going to spread that out further into the community now and say neighboring, how far are we going to go? Where's the defining limits going to be? And, you know, I see so many restrictions being put in on top of what we already have that we may never, ever be able to make a decision on anything if we have all these amendments being put in that makes it even harder to define issues. And then the one last item that I'd like to make is that with the footprint going from 5,000 to 3,500, that would also adversely impact several properties. One that I can think of, it's not mine, so I'm not bothered by it, but it would make that building also a non-conforming use. And I think these are things that we have to consider before we jump on to ideas.
Thank you. Jump right in there, Tom.
Good evening. My name's Everett Johnson. I live at 1235 Shore Road. I also have a business at 300 Ocean House Road. I hope I'm in this picture somewhere, but I think we're in the middle of the town center as it exists now. I'm here with my wife, Linda. We have some concerns about the non-conforming aspects that Mr. Tinsman brought up. We were operating under the town center plan that we thought was accepted and worked on and spent a lot of time on back in 1993. As far as I know, there hasn't been a whole lot of changes to that. And if the height requirement goes from 35 feet down to 25 feet, my business is impacted. And I also have a site plan that's been approved. It hasn't been acted upon for building a garage. That probably is going to be more than 35 feet. So just got some basic issues around that. I think the idea behind the town center is to bring buildings of 35 feet or so into the center of town so that businesses can locate there, and to restrict that I think is unfair. Thanks.
Mr. Chairman, members of the town council, I beg your indulgence. I can't guarantee that I'll restrict my comments to 3 minutes. This issue is struck.
I would hope that you would make every effort to do so.
I will certainly do so. I'll only say that if I could share 1 minute of my presentation tonight for every hour that I put into making the presentation and then forget the length of time that we work together, Councilor Reed and others in putting together the town center.
You might want to introduce yourself and give your address. Okay.
Thank you. My name is Tom Emery. I'm a resident of 12 Juniper Lane, just down the road here, known as Brentwood or Old Brentwood. I'm a member of the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board and have been on the board for about 8 years. First and foremost, I want everyone here tonight and the council and anyone at home to understand that I'm not representing an opinion of the Planning Board, nor do any of my statements this evening indicate any prejudice or favor regarding any application before the board. It's coincidental and just so happens that I was a member of the Town Center Committee and was a member of the Planning Board while this ordinance was being reviewed and having gone through several rewrites. Council really isn't, there's not a lot in terms of public input this evening that's going to, this isn't an opportunity where the council will either vote against or in favor of this amendment.
That's not necessarily true.
I guess my hope would be that perhaps I could influence you not to adopt it this evening. And for anyone who's at home, perhaps I could help in people understanding what the issue really is and why it's completely out of context in several ways. This is an unusual situation. My comments shouldn't be taken personally. I worked very closely with Bruce Cogshell, Phyllis's husband and abutter to the town center zone. We had open and many public discussions, and we also had public meetings here before we even adopted the final ordinances. Nor should any comments be taken as a specific criticism of any project. My greatest concern is that I have a sense from what I've seen in the mail and what I've been hearing. I have a neighbor who's here this evening who came with a petition to my door. And there seems to be some confusion as to what the real issue in the town center is. There's been rumors circulating regarding a Rite Aid. My concern is that what we're doing here is that we have the tail wagging the dog, that out of some real fear and scare tactics, people have made a rash decision about limiting height, both in overall height to 25 feet, as well as redefining the definition, so to speak. Several years ago, the council challenged the planning board with the notion of customer service. We as a planning board understood that customer service had two issues. One, the concerns of the abutters in the town, as well as the applicants before the board. I'm only going to say that, and I think what the issue with the board is that the board has always been a challenging board, but the board has always played by the rules, has used the ordinances, and has been fair. The town, the council, has historically been extremely diligent. We have a wonderful group of volunteers year after year, decade after decade, who have worked on comprehensive plans, who rather than going around people's backs or whatever, have been very proactive, and the development of zoning ordinances and so forth have been done in a public format, have been done in a very public process. Certainly the legwork that went behind the town center zone is included in that. One of my greatest concerns about, other than the process that we're faced with this evening, is the fact that the proposal is arbitrary and capricious.
Hold up one second. I just want to make sure. I think you're certainly planning on going for a much longer period of time. Is that not true?
I would say if I had another 5 or 6 minutes, that would cover.
And I don't want to, and I want to have the sense of the town council whether they would like Mr. Emery to continue for another 5 minutes, or whether the council would like to enforce the 3-minute rule. Councilor Reed?
Mr. Chairman, serving with Mr. Emery on the Town Center Planning Committee, I believe that he should be entitled, and I would vote to allow him to continue until conclusion of his comments.
Is there any member of the town council that would not like me to extend an additional 5 minutes to Mr. Emery?
No, I'd like to see his pictures he's hiding.
I'm sorry?
I'd like to see his pictures he's hiding in front of me. I might understand.
Councilor Fritz?
I'm happy to extend 5 minutes more to him, but I think that there aren't that many people in the audience tonight that maybe we don't have to be so strict on 3 minutes. I think we could allow people to have a little bit more say, so that he's not the only one.
One moment, Tom. Councilor Byron?
I'd just like to agree with Councilor Fritz. I think that if we're going to let one person who has a point of view speak longer, then other people should be able to as well.
Fine. And I would again, with that said, the sense of the council certainly appears to be to allow people to spend a little longer. I would ask, though, that you speak no longer than necessary. Perhaps that's a good way of defining it. I'm sorry to interrupt you, Tom.
Oh, fine. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. A point I was going to make is that the proposed language amendment certainly has unintended consequences, and I know that's a term that the chairman has expressed in several of the subcommittees that I've worked with the chairman. Because we're not only just changing the height from 35 to 25 feet, we're also, in this proposal, changing the definition, which creates another percentage of lowering it. And I'll hand out some 11 by 17s here. These are a little bit difficult to read, but may help the council a little bit. Those don't What got my attention in the situation is I live in a 1968 house. It's a fairly small, compact house over in, well, what really got my attention was the issue is why should this zone, apart from every other zone in Cape Elizabeth, be favored by not only lowering the height by 10 feet, but redefining the height, and thus by perhaps lowering it another 10 feet, if we include a daylight basement, regardless of what proportion that is. And I also wondered what every resident who signed that petition would feel like if they bought a new lot over in Stonegate, and two neighbors or several neighbors came over after having built out the entire subdivision and suggested that their house should only be one story instead of two or two and a half or three. And I also wondered if they had spent $150,000 or more on that lot, had gone to the city hall, had looked through all the ordinance, had looked at the comprehensive plan, the town center zone, had got involved in a process and had the rug pulled out from them. That's the other part of this process that really strikes a chord. It's the issue of customer service and fairness and playing by the rules. But to get to the specific issues of the diagram, the diagram on the left shows a fairly standard 1960s two-story house. That house typically had a floor-to-floor height of 9 feet in order to get the structure in, and had a sloping roof in the sort of raised ranch and two-story garrison houses. Those roof slopes might have been typically 6 and 12 to make working on them easier and less expensive in reducing the overall volume and thereby the cost of the house. Using the old definition of the ordinance, or the current definition of the ordinance, measuring from average ground, in these sections I've made an assumption that the first floor is going to be about 3 feet above average ground. And that's enough to get the framing of the floor up to have a full foundation underneath. We measure from the average ground to halfway between the eave and the ridge. The typical 1968 house with a shallow roof slope is 24 feet 6 inches. If we use the current ordinance, or the suggested petition definition, from that same average ground to that same peak on the roof, it's 28 feet. My house would be non-conforming the town center zone. And for the life of me, I can't understand why my small 1968 house should be non-conforming the town center zone. Furthermore, if I happen to be on sloping land, which is what the town center zone is comprised of in many cases, my house then, having changed anything, would be 33 feet high. It would be many, many feet above the 25-foot height limit. Now we have another category of houses in Cape Elizabeth, which I've defined in this section as 1980s to 1990s. Those houses were built where people weren't satisfied with 7 foot six or 8 foot ceilings. The ceilings now had to be 9 feet, and the floor to floor heights increased from 9 to 10 feet, and the second floor easily has a 8 foot ceiling, perhaps some cases higher. Under the current definition of the ordinance, that two story house, the other thing that's happened is that the roof pitches have increased considerably, and they're more typical of the architectural historic buildings that have 8 and 12 or 10 and 12 roof pitches. Under the current definition of the ordinance, halfway between the eave and the ridge, we have a height of 27 feet 10 inches. It doesn't conform with the town center district. If we go to a daylight basement, which many houses have in Cape Elizabeth, we're at 39 feet 8 inches. Can't build it. Doesn't conform. And again, for the life of me, why if I can build this house anywhere in Cape Elizabeth in the residential zones, why can't I build it in the town center? Now, lastly, the section on the right talks about a commercial building. Commercial buildings are different than single-family residences. They typically require more heating and ventilating equipment. They have longer spans. They have open office uses. There may be special ductwork for medical buildings. So the floor height, unless you're working within an existing historic structure that may already be faced with a lower floor to floor height, usually is increased, and it may be as much as a 10-foot ceiling or a 9-foot ceiling, but it could be easily 11 feet or 12 feet floor to floor. So if we look at simply a two-story commercial building, the other thing is they tend to be wider because you have a central corridor with offices on each side. With the minimum footprint or maximum footprint of 5,000 square feet as it currently exists and a maximum length of 100 feet, that means the building would have to be 50 feet wide. If it's shortened to 3,500 feet, then the building would be a little narrower than 50 feet. But for my example, I've used 32 feet,
And the reason I've used 32 feet is that's the width that I'm finding in many larger houses these days. I'm really wound up on this issue, so you have to bear with me.
Eventually, you're going to have to wind down.
I will wind down. But under the current ordinance, a two-story commercial building with a 12-foot first-floor height, 3 feet off the ground, with an 8-foot ceiling on the second floor, with a 10 and 12 roof pitch, which is what the town center ordinance recommends, that the pitch of the roof be relative to the other buildings in town and have historic merit, that building under the current ordinance would be 31 feet 8 inches high. It would be 31 feet from the lower grade to the second floor, and the overall height of the building, as measured by the suggested change with sloping ground, would be 44 feet 4 inches. The only thing that could be done under the proposed amendment to the zoning ordinance with a 12-foot floor-to-floor on the first floor would be a 25-foot high building that would be 3 feet off the ground, have no roof. It would be flat roof. That's all you'd have in the town center would be either single-story buildings or flat-roof two-story buildings. There would be no variety. There would be no historic context. I feel the town center ordinance is an excellent ordinance. The issue of height does not stand alone. There are lots of recommendations in there about where parking should be put, space in bulk, historic references, items that the committee specifically provided guidance in, gave examples for, but did not lock up in a very tight three-dimensional urban design diagram. We wanted flexibility. If this height is changed as it's currently recommended, there'll be no flexibility, and all of the rest of that ordinance can be just put aside unless we're looking at single-story buildings with sloped roofs. And I guess in closing, I would certainly recommend that the council not adopt this ordinance this evening. I would plead with the residents of the town that they thoroughly understand what the impact of this is, and I would ask that they consider it in the same vein as if it were in their own residential districts. I'm not sure that anyone in this town would tolerate losing the ability to build a two-story house with any architectural merit. It's contrary to the way the town typically does business. The paper said this is the first time in 30 years. There's been too much hard work put into these ordinances and into this process, and I really plead with the citizens of the town when they come, if they come before this in referendum, they really understand the implications. And I thank the council for their indulgence. Any questions? Is there anyone else?
I received some letters, and I believe the intent of these letters was for people who could not be here tonight to express their thoughts. I'm reading them in no particular order. Some are for, some are against. First one is Fran Haywood. Dear Chairman Groff, I'm writing to support the adoption of the language changes to the Town Center zoning ordinances, which are contained in the petition, which was recently presented to the Town Council by Phyllis Coggeshall. Having looked at the plans for the proposed new office building, it appears we need more modest parameters in order for any proposed building and property plan to be within the spirit, as well as the letter of the law, so that an identifiable town center that includes a, quote, village feeling will be the final result of the development of this very important piece of commercial property. There is no doubt that the appropriate development of this property can be a very useful and attractive new addition to our town center, and we look forward to seeing it unfold. Please communicate to the rest of the town council my strong desire, and Charlie's as well, to have the council adopt the ordinance changes as outlined in the petition so that the scale of the planned building or buildings will be appropriate. Thank you. If anybody wants to speak, I would love to. I have a couple of these. I'll stop and let you go. So if you want to speak, walk right up to the podium. This is a letter from Patricia Brigham. 34 Rockcrest Drive, Cape Elizabeth, Maine. Dear Town Council Member, as I cannot attend the public hearing on Wednesday, March 11th, I am writing this letter to voice my strong opposition to the proposed change in town center zoning and development regulations. I believe that if you support this initiative, you are catering to a small group of people, primarily those abutting the commercially zoned property in the quote "town center" unquote, at the expense of the vast majority of residents of this community. The initiative as presented appears to create conditions so unfavorable to a commercial enterprise that no development will ever occur, so much for that quote "village center" unquote feeling. While I applaud your efforts to manage new commercial development in this community, you can and should not be allowed to stifle it. Have you thought about the implications for the town's budget if the only source of revenue continues to be the residential property owner? How many more tax increases do you think they can handle? Additional revenues will most certainly be required when the 90-lot subdivision off of Spurwick Road, which you approved, is completed, bringing more children into a school system whose resources are already showing signs of strain. I truly believe that in order to maintain the assets that make Cape Elizabeth an attractive community and therefore uphold property values, its school system, its coastal parks, beaches, open spaces, additional sources of tax revenue must be identified. Commercial development which meets underlying existing regulations should be welcomed. Remember, commercial establishments tend to be net contributors rather than users of municipal resources, i.e. quote "they" unquote do not have children in the school system. Please consider the needs of the community, not the needs of a few individual property owners who are trying to protect their own private domain. Patricia Brigham. Walk right up. This is a letter from Frank Strout. Dear Mr. Graff, I wish to express my concerns not only for the proposed changes in the zoning requirements within the town center zone, but also for the future for the town center concept. I believe if approved, these changes will make any type of development within the town center impossible. Several years ago, I watched with great interest the recommendations the town center's study committee made in drafting the quote "master plan" unquote. My interest was not only as a resident, but also as a landowner. At the time, my family owned the former quote "Cape Fishing Farm" unquote property. The town center committee and its chair, Bruce Coggeshall, spent countless hours making sure that all citizens' concerns were addressed. At one of the well-attended public informational meetings, there was overwhelming support for the town center concept, the building design, and the restrictions placed on the property. The petition changes now brought before you, adding wording to the purpose section and changing the wording from "abutting property value" to "the value of neighboring properties" is extremely vague and is open to many interpretations. Furthermore, reducing the building height, footprint, and dimensions, along with a maximum lot coverage of 50%, would significantly change the economic feasibility of any project in the town center. Now, when I think back on the history of the town center plan and where it's gone, I can only wonder how we got to this point. I wonder, are these proposed changes to improve the committee's idea of a town center zone, or is it to end any possibility of this concept ever happening? Letter from Marion Guthrie, who was in Kansas City, who, that's her winter address, and she lives in Delano Park in the summer. Members of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, dear members of the town council, unable to attend the public hearing on March 11th, my husband and I urge you to adopt the ordinance change as requested. The new ordinance not only reflects the original intent of the town center zone, but also encourages an appropriate scale for buildings in this important zone. The new ordinance does not exclude development. It includes provisions to retain the unique qualities of our town, now and in the future. Thank you for your time and energy you expended on behalf of all of our citizens. This is Jerry and Sharon Murray. Dear Mr. Graff, as landowners, residents, and business owners in the town center zone, we would like to respond to the latest effort to change the zone one more time. This is all getting a little tiring. The town center zone was created to make a town center where residential housing and commercial ventures could work side by side. We can certainly live with it. Jerry was on that committee, and they worked long and hard to come up with a plan that each of us could adapt to, and the majority of the town would accept and endorse. It then spent many months being fine-tuned by Zork, and with public hearings, it was finally approved. Now here we are with ink barely dry, a project trying to begin, and we are being asked to change the rules to satisfy a few. We say leave the town center zone alone and give it a chance to work. The applicant, whose proposed project has generated this petition, is willing to work with the town and make this a viable project for the town center. After all, this is the town center, a mix of residential and business. We have a couple more. Memo to Mike McGovern, town manager and town councilors. It's from Ruth Watson. Dear Mike on councilors, as I will be out of town on March 11th and unable to attend the public hearing on the above issue, I am writing this memo to express my concern on the proposed changes. I was approached at the polls by Phyllis Coggeshall to sign this petition, and I declined to endorse it, as I felt strongly that our current zoning requirements are more than adequate to protect the character and charm of Cape Elizabeth. As you are aware, the current requirements were arrived at after much study, planning, and public input, and they were designed to be reasonable for anyone seeking to develop property within the town center. A further reduction in height limit to 25 feet and the building footprint to 3,500 square feet would make it very difficult for anyone to develop anything more than a very small medical or dental office. It would preclude a myriad of other options that could be very beneficial to the residents of this town. The fact is that if this petition were to be approved, that one could build a taller and larger home in the Cape than an office, which makes absolutely no sense. I have very serious reservations as to the motivations behind this petition. Cape Elizabeth has a reputation for being difficult to work with from a developer's viewpoint, which is not necessarily all bad, but I think that the Cape has always been viewed as being a fair player. This petition comes very close to treading on the rights of developers who have purchased land in Cape Elizabeth based on one set of known zoning requirements, only to have them try to be changed in the middle of the game. I don't think that is how Cape Elizabeth wants to be or should be viewed. I would strongly urge you to vote against this proposal and take a firm stand on the fact that the current guidelines were arrived at after much review and input, and that they serve the best interest of the majority of the residents of the Cape. Ruth Watson. Two more. To Planning Board of Cape Elizabeth. As one vitally interested in retaining a townscape, I'm sorry, this is in handwriting, so it's difficult for me, plan for the Pond Cove property, I am sorry to miss the proposed meeting on March 11th. I understand this meeting will determine whether there will be a May referendum regarding the language of our present zoning ordinance for the town center. As a petition signer and as a gatherer of signatures, I was impressed with the interest, concern, and something that was expressed by a cross-section of Cape residents.
Sentiment.
How fortunate we are to live in a community that turns out to vote, cares about issues, and has a sense of pride about the place they have chosen to live in. Let's cap our heights, keep our vision, and let the people of the Cape be heard on May 11th. Millicent Veteran, Canterbury, Cape Elizabeth. I have a letter from Bruce Coggeshall. I'm writing concerning the petition that has been submitted seeking to change the town center zoning ordinance by reducing the intensity of permitted development within the zone. I believe that this petition reflects the sentiment of a large majority of the citizens of this town, and that buildings as massive as that proposed by the Cape Elizabeth Land Company should not be permitted, and that appropriate steps should promptly be taken to assure that this cannot happen to our town. As you know, you have two choices in dealing with this petition. You can either adopt the ordinance as submitted, or you can send it to a voter referendum. I firmly believe that the people of Cape Elizabeth will vote favorably on the referendum question. However, for the reasons explained below, I think it would be a wiser choice for the town council to acknowledge the inappropriateness for our town of the existing ordinance and itself vote to adopt the proposed ordinance rather than sending it out to referendum. While I think that the general sense of the proposed ordinance as drafted reflects the overwhelming sentiment of the citizens of this town and clearly comports with what was intended for the town center, I recognize that it might have been drafted differently if the town council and the town's professional planners had focused on the ordinance and themselves prepared an amendment addressing the citizens' concerns. The ordinance may well need some tweaking at the margins. If the council were to adopt the proposed ordinance, it would be much easier for the council to thereafter do any necessary tweaking than it would be if the ordinance were adopted as a result of a referendum vote. In order to address the concerns of the citizens of this town and to get this ordinance changed promptly and plea, I urge you to vote to adopt it. I think it is important to prevent development on the scale proposed by the Cape Elizabeth Land Company, and I think that the proper action should be taken to see that this is done. If the council determines to not adopt the proposed ordinance, then I would urge you to send it out for a vote at an early date. Thank you for your consideration of this important issue. Very truly yours, Bruce Cogger. They are the letters that I have received. If any town councilor received any other letter from an individual who was not able to be here tonight, please feel free to read it. I think it's important that the public have as much information as possible. Is there anyone else in the audience who wishes to speak? Is there any councilor that wishes to communicate a citizen's letter that could not be here tonight or corresponded with you and asked you to express their viewpoint? Hearing none, I declare this public hearing closed. Now, is there at this point in time a motion by any member of the council as to how to proceed? Councilor Reed.
Mr. Chairman, as a member of the town center zone and a member of the town council in 1990 with Bill Jordan, when the last citizens initiative appeared before the town council, when a member of the public asked how to expand the school board from 5 to 7, at that time the greater good for the community was well known, and it was decided that after the petition signatures were certified that the question would go to the voters in the November general election. And thanks to Mr. Emery's comments being extended, my 2 pages has just ended, so you got your time back. And I make that motion that the town council send this out in the November general election for a vote by the public.
I second.
It's been moved and seconded that this matter be set for referendum in the general election in November. Discussion on the motion.
Could I make a ask for a clarification?
Certainly.
Our town attorney has recommended for clarity, not to change the meaning or intent of the ordinance, but for clarity, some changes in the wording. And as I understand it, those changes are now part of the proposal.
That's my understanding, so that everybody's clear, is under the charter, and we have our town attorney here, and he can correct me if I'm wrong, the town attorney had an obligation under our charter to, if there was clarifying language necessary, to do that, but he couldn't change the intent. He couldn't change the substance. And he has done that. It is my understanding, and Tom, correct me if I'm wrong, that since you have fulfilled your obligation under the charter, that what you have now done with those, and I'll call them minor clarifications, that is what would be voted on at any referendum. Is that correct?
That's correct.
So it's implicit, Councilor Berry, that what we're sending to referendum is the petition as, let's say, clarified by the town council.
But not amended.
But not amended.
Okay.
That's right. Clarified but not amended. Is there discussion on the pending motion? Councilor McGinty.
There's no doubt in my mind that considering the controversy around this issue that it has to go to the people, I certainly put my trust in the people to decide this issue. My only question or concern is the date of the referendum, November 3rd, I believe is the date. I would like to get some closure on this sooner than that. And we have 2 opportunities prior to that, May 5th and the primary election on June 9th, and I'm wondering if there's any support for moving it up to either one of those dates rather than, you know, extend this issue. Again, I'd like to see closure on this one way or the other.
Are you asking at this point in time whether the individual who made the motion would accede to a modification of an earlier date?
Yeah, I'd like to have some discussion regarding that, sure.
No, and the reason that I made my opening comments was because we do have precedent, and it was the last election, the last citizens' initiative where we, and again, it was just Billy and I at the time, but the discussion was that when an item that could impact, which it does have financial ramifications for the entire town, when an item has impact for the entire town, it should be at the general election as opposed to those primary elections when only registered voters of a party would come, or the municipal election when people who are not necessarily or coming just for a certain thing. And the other issue is at municipal elections, we have had some with as low voter turnout as 300 people. And that would not be a fair representation.
I'm going to step out of my chair capacity for 1 minute and also comment on this. I am very concerned that as much information on this issue be presented to the citizens of Cape Elizabeth as possible. It is my position that the November referendum date is much better, because when we get done with this process, if no one else has a motion, I will be making a motion to refer this ordinance to the ordinance committee for their comments, for then the public to have a chance to again talk to the ordinance committee and the expertise of the ordinance committee to be brought to bear as to the definitions of various words, as to what the impact would be, and then I would ask that this petition also go to the planning board so that the expertise of the planning board can be brought to this petition, so that the planning board can answer questions such as were as raised tonight of what can be built there, what can't be built there, what's the fiscal impact on the town if nothing's built there, and for any purpose other than reporting back to the council and reporting back to the citizens of this community so that they can be informed. Then I would suggest further, and I will suggest if this motion passes, that there be another public hearing prior to the election, prior to the referendum date, so that people can then have the expertise of our planning board, the expertise of the ordinance committee. I hope also that what's encouraged is a debate of some kind, right? People pro and against, so that it can be televised. Because my concern as the chair is that there be a vote, but there be a vote based upon people understanding the issue, having every opportunity to have every question answered, and utilizing the expertise of this community that we've developed over years and years of looking at our ordinances and going through Zork, and so that people can draw on that expertise and be guided in their vote one way or the other by the facts rather than just by innuendo or emotion. And I'm afraid, John, that if we don't move it to November, there won't be an opportunity for these various groups in town that have this expertise to address this issue, and there won't be an opportunity for the Cape Courier to cover this, for public debate, and it's such an important issue in our town. We spent years doing Zork, and what's the rush? Why not let the light of day shine, and if it's a great idea and a great ordinance modification, I'm sure the citizens of this town they're incredibly bright, and they will pass it. And if it's the majority of citizens decide when they understand everything that it's not a good idea, then it'll be defeated. And what have we conceivably lost by allowing this educational opportunity to be expanded? Councilor McGinty.
You know, certainly I want all sides of the issue to be heard and for all the experts to be able to give their, you know, rendition of what this will, how this will impact the town. I'm not so sure I agree totally. I'm not going to oppose this motion simply because of the date. I think it needs to go to the people. But I would say that I don't agree with the analysis by Councilor Reed necessarily. I think if it's held during the municipal election and is perhaps, other than the council election, is the only item on the ballot, people will be going there educated about the issue and going to vote on it. If they go during the presidential or the congressional elections in November, people may have no information, may have not even thought about this issue, may be going to vote for candidates for Congress or the legislature or whatever, and cast an uninformed vote, despite the time. And also, there's a time. You know, November's a long way away. This is an issue that's confronting us here and now, and, you know, I would like to, again, see some closure. The property owner has some right to closure on this. If there's a building season that he has an opportunity to build something, he's going to lose that probably. And the abutters obviously have a desire to have some closure on this also to see what their options are. And so that's why I'd like to see it earlier. I won't oppose, you know, I'm not going to vote not to put it on the ballot because of that. But that's my reasoning for putting it earlier rather than later.
Councilor Jordan.
You took half of my speech away in finding out. I wanted to find out the process of, I don't see the vote here, to put this before the ordinance committee and then back to the planning board, and I'm very much in favor of that. I don't want to burden myself with any more work, but I think that should be the process if you're making a change in an ordinance. Thank you.
Councilor Fitz.
I guess I would like to agree with the comments of Councilor McGinty. I am concerned about an issue being delayed that may affect the plans of the property owner that's affected by this, and I am concerned about issues getting buried in statewide issues and, you know, at the general election. We do have about 2 months. I don't think planning board, previous town center committee members, comprehensive planning committee members, I think they could step up and make comments within the next 2 months and make an intelligent discussion and debate about this. So I will move to amend the motion to have a May 5th date for the election.
One moment. Is there a second to the motion to amend?
I'll second it for the purpose of discussion.
All right. So what is now before the council is an amendment to the motion to move the date from November until May
5th.
5th. May 5th? May 5th. That is what's being discussed right now. I would ask a question, is that amount of time, would it be able to go to the ordinance committee, have a hearing? Would it be able to go to the planning board for a hearing and their input back, and then have it back in time for the council to then have a public hearing so that people can comment on the expertise that's been and the recommendations and discussion that's been generated by those two entities, and still do all that by the May 5th date? Or is it your intent not to allow that to happen?
I'm not sure the council ought to really be setting up a process that, because the charter, I think, is taking an issue, allowing the citizens to take an issue directly to the voters rather than, and be able to bypass the council. And they ought to be able to continue with that process. I think it's very important to have a debate, but I think that can take place without us saying the planning board has to hold a hearing and has to fit in all of these processes.
You don't think it's important to, for this council and for the citizens of this community to have access to the expertise of our planning board and our ordinance committee that's been developed over the years, that's obviously considered ZORC for years before adoption, and you don't think that that's important for the citizens of this community to have that type of input?
I think it's very important to have that kind of input, but I don't think it has to be a structured wait till their meeting, have a public hearing, and set up all that time frame that delays the process and delays the decision making.
So then implicit in your modification of, or in your amendment, is the idea that it would be unnecessary for us to establish any type of process to allow or request that these various entities look at this matter and report back to us, and that we have the ability to have another public hearing on this issue. Is that the gist of what you're saying?
I think we could have a public hearing, but I think we could also set up a roundtable and invite all the people who have participated on the planning board and town center and have it televised and inform people that way. I mean, I don't think it has to be a...
Councilor Reed.
Could we just remind Councilor Fritz that we start budget negotiations a week from Saturday? And we have 8 meetings scheduled in the next 2 months.
I think you just did.
That's a good point.
Is there other discussion, and we're discussing now the proposed amendment? Hearing no further... Oh, I'm sorry.
I would say, well, first of all, the planning board isn't involved in the budget negotiations, so they can go off and do their thing. And I think 2 months is plenty of time to even have a structured process. They can schedule a meeting anytime. They could have a special meeting just to deal with this issue, and probably should. Likewise for the ordinance committee. I'm on that committee. I don't think we have anything in front of us right now. We could schedule a meeting tomorrow if we wanted to. Legally we can, but, well, whenever we could, next week maybe. But I think there's plenty of time, and I agree. I think there should be a debate, if you want to call it that, between both sides of this issue, and have it televised, and bring in the experts, and have everybody discuss the entire issue.
Thank you. I have one other comment.
I kind of agree with Councilor Baghetti there. I think we should go through the process. I think the meetings could be scheduled if they want to do it. It may be a little extra work and what have you, but that's what you're here for. And it's a good time of year to do it, whether it's nice.
My other problem with, just so everything's on the table, with the having this go to referendum in May, is that there are lots of important issues in this town. There are lots of things coming up, and this is an important municipal election. I mean, there is, this isn't, and I would hate to see this municipal election be based in large part upon one issue that overshadows everything else. I would hate to see one debate, just one debate. One debate's enough on this issue. I don't think that's true, because I think it's going to take a period of time to capture people's attention in this town, because people in this town are busy people. Tonight, I would say the vast majority of people in this community don't even know that there was a public hearing tonight. And it's only through an educational process that extends over a period of time that you end up getting people's attention, through a couple issues of the Cape Courier sitting there and saying this is an issue, through numerous debates. The concept of, in this town, having one defining debate where 7,100 voters are going to find the time to listen in to one particular presentation of the issues just doesn't happen. That's not how this town works. And I'm concerned that what would happen then is that we'd have a large number of individuals divide into camps for our municipal election. We have always had nonpartisan municipal elections. We don't have Republicans, we don't have Democrats, we have individuals that run, and we haven't had a one-issue municipal election, and I would hate to see it start now. And that's why I will vote against this amendment, because I believe it's for the better good of this town that the more people, either way you vote, you know, for or against, but the more people that understand what they're voting for, the better this town will be. And that's why I will vote against this amendment. Is there further discussion? Councilor Byer.
Thank you. I would like just to, I guess, weigh in as long as everyone else has. I'm comfortable with November, and the reason I am is because of kind of what you were just saying and several others did. But I want to applaud Mr. Emery, who spent some time, came in with the three houses over there and showed us some information that I think, for me at least, was enlightening. I had no idea how many stories you could get into 25, 35 feet, none at all. So I think that was constructive. I'm not saying that I agree or disagree, but it was constructive information. And I think if we make a process that goes out to the Ordinance Committee and the Planning Board, we have an opportunity to get constructive input, and the community can listen to that. And that's good, and they can reach whatever conclusion they want. But I'd rather err on the side of giving enough time to get enough information out so that everyone has an opportunity to find out, in fact, what they want to do. That's my thought.
Further discussion? Hearing none, call.
Would the status quo be maintained until the election, or are we going to be rendered moot?
Well, I think I don't want to give a legal opinion. Our attorney's right here.
The text of the petition states that it shall apply to all applications which have not been finally approved by the Planning Board prior to the date of the submission of the petition.
Of this petition.
Yeah. So that's stopped. That's the date. It has retroactive effect to that date, regardless if it's voted on. It'll be effective 10 days after it's voted on. But regardless of when it's voted on and when it's effective, it would apply this back to the date it was submitted.
And Councilor, just so that the public's clear, that isn't just, we're not just talking about the Elizabeth Land, Cape Elizabeth Land Company in the woods. We're talking about any project in the town center, including if a property owner had in the process of trying to build a garage, that nothing can happen if that's a non-conforming use until this referendum is decided. Is that right?
That's correct.
No.
Well,
if someone had a garage and they wanted to apply, they could choose to do it under the current standards, or they could choose to do it under the proposed. If they do it under the proposed, they're taking a risk because the provisions might be retroactive.
Mm-hmm. If it's been finally approved, as somebody mentioned a site plan tonight, if that has been finally approved, I think they're okay.
Okay. Is there any other discussion? Hearing none, and call the vote, roll call vote.
Could you repeat it?
And I would ask the clerk to repeat the amendment. We're just simply voting on the amendment to the motion. Madam Clerk?
The amendment to the motion would be to, for the council to sign the warrant, including the clarifications by the town attorney. The warrant would state a May 5th, 1998 election, special municipal election.
Special municipal?
That's the amendment. That's the amendment.
That's the amendment we're voting on now. We're voting on whether it should be on May 5th rather than the original motion being in November. All in favor of the Councillor Fritz amendment?
Roll call vote.
Roll call vote. Madam Clerk.
Councillor Barry?
Yes.
Councillor Byer?
No.
Councilor Fritz?
Yes.
Councilor Jordan?
Yes.
Councilor McGinty?
Yes.
Councilor Reed?
No. Chairman Groff?
No.
Motion carries, four yeas, three nays.
So the motion, the amendment to the motion is now approved. That would make the referendum date June...
May
5th. So the original motion then needs to be voted on.
Right, which would be, I'm sorry, the, to sign the warrant, including the clarifications by the town attorney for May 5th, 1998.
No, the original was November.
No, but it's been amended.
Been amended.
I see.
That carried. Amendment carried.
Thank you.
Further discussion on the underlying motion. Hearing none, where...
Well, I think that 1,000 people having signed a petition for a referendum, it should go out to the people on a referendum vote. And since we picked that date, I say proceed with it.
Further discussion?
I didn't quite get what he said. You got to speak into your mic, so I'm a little out of here and getting old.
So am I. I said 1,000 people have signed a petition asking for a vote, and I think we should proceed with it.
I agree with the vote.
Thank you.
Just when. What he said, if I understood him correctly, that the people signed a petition for a vote, and I agree that we should have the vote, but when should we have it?
Well, the motion now is that, just so we're all on the same wavelength, the motion, the original motion was to have the vote in November. That motion's now been amended, and the motion before the council now is to have the referendum vote in May.
That's correct.
All right. Is there any further discussion?
Roll call?
Roll call vote.
Counselor Barry?
Yes.
Counselor Beyer?
Yes.
Counselor Fritz?
Yes.
Counselor Jordan?
Yes.
Counselor McGinty?
Yes.
Counselor Reed?
No.
Chairman Groff?
Yes.
Motion carries, six yeas, one nay.
I have another motion on the same topic. I have a I'd like to make a motion that the town council request that as expeditiously as possible the ordinance committee and the planning board study this issue and report back to the town council and to the public as to their view of the specifics of the ordinance, in particular but not limited to what type of buildings could be built if in fact the height restriction, if these restrictions are applied, what the term neighbor means compared to a butter, and further attempt to define all other language set forth in the ordinance for the purpose not of up and down, but for the purpose of providing further guidance to the citizens of this town as to the meaning of this ordinance. And I would also include as part of this motion the request that the town council conduct another public hearing subsequent to receiving the review of the ordinance committee and the planning board, again for the purpose of attempting to provide additional materials and education for the citizens of this town prior to the referendum vote.
Mr. Chairman, could you make that at least, say, 10 days prior to the election?
No.
Does that seem fair?
I think that's more than fair. I would amend the motion to say that at the earliest opportunity, the planning board and the ordinance committee report back to the town council, but in no event shall the town council have a public hearing. The town council should endeavor to have a public hearing at least 10 days prior to the referendum.
I second the motion.
Is there a discussion?
Yes. You going to number that as 114A?
Yeah, let's number that. Let's number that as 114A.
Okay. Thank you.
Councilor Reed.
Does that mean we'll be having a special town council meeting to have that public hearing?
That means that we will be having a special, in my view, if in fact we cannot fit it into the April meeting, then we would end up having to meet the terms of this, a special meeting of the town council to address this issue.
Thank you.
Further discussion? Councilor Barry.
I think that's an excellent idea to have the input from the people, but I also think that that your amendment to give the people a little breathing time before the actual voting day is a good idea, and so I would support the motion.
Further discussion?
No, I'm in favor of it.
Right.
Just hope Debbie's got it all down.
I do.
All in favor? Opposed? Carries 7-0. Just so we understand, the town manager will be, because of the expeditious nature of what we have to do, I assume all the town council members agree that the town manager will be communicating with the ordinance committee and the planning board at his earliest opportunity to relay what we're requesting. Any sense to that concept? Hearing none, we'll move on. Item 115, action to refer the proposed municipal budget to the Finance Committee.
I so move, Mr. Chairman.
Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Councilor Fitz. Discussion?
I don't know if the manager wanted to mention, but I'd like to mention some of the dates for the budget hearings.
Sure.
That's okay.
Yeah.
The Finance Committee will be reviewing the town budget, the municipal budget, on several dates, starting on Saturday, March 21st, which will be an all-day session here at Town Hall. Additional reviews will occur on Thursday, March 26th, Monday, March 30th, Monday, April 6th. We'll be reviewing the school budget on April 15th, which is a Wednesday, and on Thursday, April 16th, hopefully complete the budget review and set the public hearing. The public hearing will be on Monday, May 4th, here at Town Hall. Some council members have indicated they may have a conflict on some of those dates. We're going to have to get together, perhaps after this meeting, and confirm that everybody can make all those dates.
Yeah.
If they are modified, certainly any modifications will be put out on cable TV and or the Cape Courier if that's available in time. Thank you.
May I just ask a question as far as time on those scheduled meetings? Are the weekday meetings at 7:30 generally, and the first one on a Saturday, what time does that begin?
8 o'clock.
8 o'clock?
8 a.m.
Mm-hmm. 8 a.m.
Joe, you'll be the only one.
not 10, Rosemary. 8.
And the town manager will provide the coffee.
Debbie will.
Seriously, it's 8 o'clock.
Yeah. On that, just a reminder to councilors is that the Finance Committee chair had suggested we use a checklist system in terms of what you want to be doing for actually the specific items you want to review. And if you could get those in just as soon as possible, that would be appreciated. I'm not going to be in next week, and Deborah may be finalizing the schedule, but it's important for us to know so that we can get the folks scheduled in that you need to meet with.
We need to vote on the motion, don't we?
Yes.
All in favor? Opposed? 7-0. We have now referred the proposed municipal budget to the Finance Committee. Item 116, action to refer the proposed special funds budget to the Finance Committee.
I so move.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor? Opposed? Item 117, action to approve a quitclaim deed to Peter J. and Jan Palanza for property located at 5 Short Road.
Thank you.
Madam Clerk.
Yes. Actually, there are going to be two requests before the council this evening for quitclaim deeds. I'm happy to bring forth. The first one is for Peter J. Palanza. Mr. Palanza has presented a certified bank check in excess of $11,000 that pays for taxes from 95 through 98. If you'll note, January of 97, we did foreclose on the property for an unpaid tax lien. The quitclaim is ready for your signature this evening. There is one slight amendment to the packet information that went out to the council. I'm asking that you sign it back to Peter J. Palanza only. Jan M. has assigned interest back to Mr. Palanza, and it has been recorded at the registry recently per a divorce decree from several years ago. So I'd recommend that the council authorize the manager to sign a quitclaim deed to Peter J. Palanza for property located at 5 Short Road.
So moved.
I'll second it. I have a question. Has that decree been presented to the town? Do we know that for sure? Has that been?
It has been filed at the registry. Our town attorney has.
Town attorney verified that.
Verified.
All right,
thank you.
Fine. Right.
Just for clarification, a question. You'd indicated all taxes, but all fines, all interest, all everything.
Taxes, interest, fees. Yes.
Thank you.
Further discussion?
I don't think there are any fines for civil matters. Whatever.
We are right now talking about item 117 only. That's Peter and Jan Palanza. Even though the clerk talked about two, we're just doing item 117 now. All in favor? Opposed?
John's up there.
Yep, John's there too. 7-0. Item 118, action to approve a quitclaim deed to Inez L. Brennick for property located 558 Ocean House Road. Do you have anything to add, Madam Clerk?
To add, no, I do not.
Is there a motion?
I'll make that motion.
Second.
Second.
First. I have a question. Do
discussion.
Go ahead. Do we
authorize
the town manager to execute this, or do the members of the council execute this document?
The town manager does, Councilor Barry.
Okay.
So you authorize him to sign
it. We authorize him at this meeting,
mm-hmm.
and he actually executes the document.
Exactly.
Thank you.
Further discussion? Hearing none, call a motion. All in favor? Opposed? 6-0. Mr. McGinty is temporarily excused.
Should that be worded in the minutes to, it says to approve a quitclaim deed. Is it understood that the manager is to do the execution?
It is understood that the manager will, we have approved the manager to execute the quitclaim deed.
Fine.
Action 119, item 119, action to approve the award of a bid for replacement fire truck. I would like to ask that this particular item be referred to the Finance Committee. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
I'll second.
Second. Further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Yeah. Is the matter tabled?
No, the matter is just referred to the Finance Committee.
Without any action of the council.
Without any action of the council. Item 120, action upon bids for construction of ball fields. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. We opened bids this past Thursday on the proposed ball fields that's to be located at Cape Elizabeth Lions Field, as well as at Fort Williams Park. These fields were originally approved as part of a very lengthy process by the town council, analyzing all the different needs for fields. as well as analyzing different locations, even to the point of having a special facilitator come in at one point to see where there might be consensus on the issue. Ultimately, the council did vote to approve the ball fields. My recollection is unanimous vote based on the compromises that were made. Since that time, you've looked at the issue a couple of times, authorized applications to the planning board. The planning board made several modifications to the plan, all of which were very positive, and they provided a very meaningful contribution. However, you know, as a result of any review like that, oftentimes there are more requests and demands placed on what needs to be done, and that did occur, and that did result in a little bit more cost. At this point in time, the bids, as we looked at the economics of the project, it showed that we were about $60,000 short of where we needed to be in terms of the contributions that have been made and in terms of the town contribution. From the beginning, when the council was first approached on this, it was with the discussion that the cost would be split 50-50, with 150 coming out of the town coffers and 150 coming out of the field for Cape Kids coffers. They have had a very successful fundraising to date. The fundraising chair is here, as well as the president of Little League and a few other interested citizens, and they can update you on the fundraising, but it seems to be going reasonably well, and contributions are rapidly coming in again as a result of a contribution letter that was sent up to citizens this past week. What I'm recommending is that you authorize me to sign the contract upon my satisfactory indication that the Field for Cape Kids group has raised $156,000 in cash and firm pledges. Back several years ago, we looked at firm pledges and, you know, what's a firm pledge. And basically what we look at are those that are given by established groups within the community, i.e. Little League and soccer, that we really can't depend for the purposes of this that, you know, some citizen sends a note saying they're going to send $5,000. We can't depend that that's going to come in.
Can we secure it by a mortgage on their home?
No, we wouldn't do that. So that wouldn't be a firm pledge. So we're really looking at the pledges from groups.
Including businesses such as Hannaford, if they were spreading their monies over 3 years,
that
would be a firm pledge.
That's a firm. Someone we, you know, have a track record. Not that the citizen we wouldn't trust, but, you know, this is the town's business. We've got to be real careful how we proceed with it. I think what's really good news, we're very close to finally getting this project underway after a whole lot of work by a whole lot of people. I had a meeting last Friday with the fundraising group, several of whom are here this evening, and the discussion then was, you know, let's challenge each other, I think is the way it came out, that challenge them to raise an additional $30,000 to fill the gap, as well as to confirm some very significant in-kind contributions, which are part of their share of the project, and challenge the town council, in essence, although I don't know, I hate to challenge the town council, use that term, it's not proper for a manager, but to, you know, really give you the opportunity to think of whether or not you want to give the balance of the $30 so that the project can get underway this particular season. The $30,000 in town funds would come from unexpended balances in different accounts, primarily in the capital improvement funds. We've been fortunate, we've had a number of savings in the, for example, in the town hall painting, and some of the different equipment, and some of the ongoing work at the library. We've also had a really good revenue history. Just last Friday, I discovered, totally out of the blue, we're about to get a check for $27,000 as part of a workers' comp dividend, which we've never gotten. But, you know, our workers' comp record has just been so positive. So, you know, where things are looking good financially, the town's in a good position. So what I'm recommending to you is that you authorize me to sign the contract upon my satisfaction that the group has raised the $156,000 in cash and firm pledges, and that you authorize $30,000 in additional town funds from unexpended funds and other accounts. The memo says capital improvement. I'm pretty close we can come to it just in the capital improvement. I'm a little bit nervous whether or not all 30,000 is there, but it's really, really close, and you know, it's obvious looking at other accounts in the budget that the money is more than there. Aside from that, you know, as I mentioned, the members of the fundraising committee are here to answer any questions that you may have. And also, Steve Harding and Bob Malley are here. I think a really other unique piece of this is we also challenged the town engineer, the director of public works, and the low bidder to whittle down the bid a little bit, the successful bidder. It's a process we've used before, something called value engineering, in terms of really looking at the bid. You know, is there a way that you can bring the bid so it was at 100% of the original estimate instead of at 107%? When I say the original estimate, I meant the most recent architect and engineer's estimate. And they met last Thursday with Gorham Sand and Gravel, and again today, and they can give you the particulars on it, but they did receive confirmation from the contractor today that will also work out as well, so that you know we can do the project as economically as possible. So that's my presentation on this issue, and I'd be happy to answer any questions, and I know there's members of the fundraising group, the president of Little League, as well as the engineer and the director.
Do you mean today they agreed to do this for 100% of the estimate? Did they reduce it by 7%?
Yes, they did.
Yeah, I didn't understand.
Mr. McGovern, am I correct in my assumption that this private group, Field for Cape Kids, has raised more money from more individuals for a public project than any such project in the history of this town?
From more within the community. I think the only exception would be the Portland Headlight Project, but an awful lot of that money came from outside the community. As far as you know, an amount of community raised within the community for community project, this group has raised more than any other fundraising for the town in the town's history. When I say the town, for a town government project, as opposed to you know, a church project or something like that.
Councilor McGinty.
I'm happy to see this, certainly. I think this was one of the, I think I took a vote on this, I think my first day I was on the council, if I'm not mistaken. So that's been 3 years this has been, you know, in the works. And I supported it then, obviously I support it now, and I'm going to vote to authorize the manager to enter into the contract. My only question is, and I think you really answered it, that this $33,000 something will not impact other programs we have. We have this money to provide. Okay, that's all I need to say.
I'm not going to ask any department head to do something that was otherwise planned to. But if they come in asking for extra money for something else, I will take a harder look at it, and you know, they're more likely to hear no.
I just want to make sure we have the money. And I also compliment the Fields for Kids. They did a great job raising this money, obviously.
And it's not, you at home, it's not too late to send them a contribution. Councilor Reed.
Since Councilor McGinty brought up that it's been 3 years from the vote that you started with to now, isn't part of the reason for that additional funding that's necessary due to the length of time it's taken to get this project to this point, and also because of changes that the planning board made in site plan review, which caused an increase over the original estimates?
It's all those things. You know, when the original cost estimate, I think, but more than any of that, it was when the original cost estimate was prepared, the design wasn't done. It was conceptual at that point. And any time you actually design a project, you just have a much better handle on the cost than during the conceptual phase.
Well, I'm certainly going to vote to support this, and we'll make the motion when an appropriate time.
Councilor Jordan.
In the bidding here, and I didn't read all the little nitty-gritty part, are they running water up to this place? Is there public water going up to this field?
There's water immediately adjacent to it. One of the issues that we're looking for in-kind contributions is to have an irrigation system under the field, so it'll be a lot easier to maintain.
Well, I was reading about the irrigation system that they want to put under the field, and I just wondering if you're going to get the water from the brook or you're going to run the water up.
We would tap over out. We're tapping the water line that goes down to Portland Headlight. That same water line.
same lot line?
Which, you know, you may not be in the council 2 years from now, but you'll be watching at home, I'm sure. And one of the, we do have inadequate capacity in that line as it now is, so we're going to have to be very careful when we're watering in terms of the timing. It'll have to be done.
That was my next question. You answered it for me, and I won't be here in 2 years from now.
Because, you know, at some point, we're going to come back to the council and ask for money to enhance that water line all the way to the lighthouse in order to protect that property.
Further discussion?
Now, does this include when they do Family Field?
Lions Field.
Lions Field, I should say.
Yes.
And where do you get to water? You're going to run the water from the present field up to it?
Yeah, continuing down the Linnell driveway, I call it.
Okay. Thank you.
Councilor Byer.
Thank you. I would like to applaud the people who have raised the money and supported the program. It's hard work to accomplish that. I've been very pleased to see that we've been able, as a town, to raise money for the Cliff Walk. I think there are other groups I know that support the library and other things in the town. I think that's very laudable, and I applaud your hard work, and I hope that we'll be able, as we look forward to doing other projects, to find generous people in the community to help as well. So it's a nice program. Thank you.
Further discussion? Councilor Fritz.
I just wanted to ask a little, what constitutes the firm pledges from groups? I mean, are those actually, they have pledges in hand, those groups, or they still have to go out and raise the money? They've just pledged to do it.
The substantial pledges that we've received are from Hannaford Brothers, who I just presume will raise the money over the next 4 years. I would hope so. From Cape Elizabeth Little League and from the soccer group. They have a traditional history of fundraising. No, they have not raised them. But they understand the commitment. They have already given Little League their first $6,000, I believe. They're looking at giving it over as, you know, the firm amount isn't set as the number of years yet, because they're really hoping to raise as much from the public over the next month or so, and not from having to, you know, do it further in pledges. They're really hoping for more cash. But those are the, that's, to answer your question, most of the pledge amount we're looking at is from Cape Elizabeth Little League, and I consider that to be a firm pledge when all of those parents sign on.
But what it really does is encumber, and for those of you who don't understand how our youth activities work, most parents pay a fee. In Little League, they pay a fee for the child to play soccer. And what we're really talking about is those organizations agreeing, in large part, that those fees parents are paying are going to be encumbered by enough to make their contribution every year to the town. Now, of course, they try to supplement those fees collected with other fundraising activities. But what we're really saying, what those organizations are saying, is they're building into their budget the fact that they have to make that contribution to the town each year to play on the fields. So
this money would be coming in over a period of time, but we'd have to pay it out to construct the field up front.
And that's how the proposal was originally authorized, I believe, prior to you.